Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom. And today we have Mark of the Church and Sign of God. I believe this is a teaching that's going to, it may open some eyes for some people. It may challenge some people. It may upset some people. But the intention is always, as always, to bring truth. It's to edify, to bring people to a place of repentance. And that's what this is there for today. And with that being said, I have to confess, I do have a lengthy teaching, or a bit longer, so we're going to forego the announcements for today. We're going to start with prayer, and then we're going to get straight in, Shabbat Shalom, to the teaching. Okay, so let's pray, and then we can begin. Father in heaven, today it is our desire to please you. So we have set this day aside to meet with you, so we can do your will, so we can find ourselves pleasing before your sight. So Father, it is our prayer that you will look upon us today, that we will be before you without blemish, without spot, without wrinkle. And if there be anything in us which isn't pleasing in your sight, we pray that we will be cleansed by the washing of the word, that we will be set apart and sanctified by your truth. Father, we accept and acknowledge Yeshua as the remission of our sins, the sacrificial lamb that took our place. We also recognize that he is the one who took hold of the penalty, the debt. So we place all of our burdens on him, knowing that he is able, when we are weak, to be strong on our behalf. So Father, this day, we pray that you'll use us as your ambassadors for the kingdom, a righteous people who have been called to declare your truth. May this truth go out far and wide. May the seed of truth, the word, be sown into good ground so it may bear full fruit. We know that right now there is no limitations to where the internet can take the voice of your people. And we also know that there is no limitations to what your presence and your spirit is able to accomplish. So we ask that you use this teaching, you use this ministry, you use me, and you use your people to accomplish your will in the earth. May we be a light which draws all people towards us and leading people to you. In Yeshua's name, amen. Hallelujah. So the mark of the church and sign of God. So again, this teaching will be one which I believe is going to provide some revelation. And the inspiration came to me not too long ago when I was contemplating on the fact that I've been speaking with some people, I've been studying with some people, and it just seems that when Father has given people an ear to hear and he puts in front of them someone who is able to minister truth, someone who's able to use the Bible, then the seed will go in and it will bear full fruit. So this teaching and this teaching series, essentially, I pray will be used in the same way the seed has been used to bear full fruit, but for a much wider audience. And I'm hoping that everyone will get behind it and share it with their friends, their family, and it will be used in that way for them as well. So, let's begin. Days before his crucifixion, Yeshua Messiah issued his final warnings to his disciples regarding deception that will abound after his ascension. This is what Yeshua said to his disciple only a few days before his crucifixion and his ascension. Take heed that no man deceive you. Plano. For many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, I am Messiah, or I am the Anointed One, and shall deceive. And that word, planeo, is the 4105 in the Greek. And it pretty much means what we think it means, to cause, to stray, to lead astray, lead aside from the right way. And for many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. And that's taken from Matthew 24 and verse 4. Now, when we look at the Oxford Dictionary, what it lets us know is that deception, or to deceive, is to deliberately cause someone to believe something that is not true. That's deception, especially for personal gain. So when we can cross-reference the Greek with the English in terms of what the word deception means, Yeshua is letting his disciples know that there will be people who profess themselves to be the Messiah, to be Christ, to be the incarnation of the Heavenly Father on earth. There will also be false prophets. And what they will be doing is leading people astray deliberately from the truth. From the perspective of Messiah, deception is to deliberately cause someone to be led astray, to be led away from the right path of truth, which he, Yeshua the Messiah, came to reintroduce to Israel. In John chapter 1, verse 14, a passage of scripture which over time has caused much confusion and debate and division, but really, when we understand the gospel of the kingdom, it's very, very straightforward. Verse 14, and the word was made flesh. Now, when we begin to read the beginning of the chapter, we know that in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. In this verse is saying, and the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. What's often overlooked in passages like this is the fact that the Word was in the beginning. The Word was there in the beginning. The Word was with God, and it was full of grace and truth. Now, if you've come from a dispensational background, or if you've come from a place where you encounter people who believe in the dispensation, they will obviously argue that there was no grace until Jesus. But John is letting us know that in the beginning was the Word, and in the beginning, that Word, which became flesh, was full of grace and truth. Which is why, and we dealt with this in the teaching series, For by Grace Are You Saved, the Bible tells us that Noah found grace. The Bible tells us that if you cry out unto Jehovah, that he will hear your cry and will be gracious to you. The Bible tells us that Moses cried out for grace and he received it. So I recommend that teaching. John bare witness of him and cried, saying, this was he of whom I spake. He that cometh after me is preferred before me, for he was before me. And of his fullness have all received, and grace for grace. For the law was given by, and that word by essentially means through. For the law was given through Moses, and but here, as we've looked at before, is in italics. That means that the but is added. For the law was given through Moses, grace and truth came by Jesus Christ, Yeshua, Messiah. Yeshua is the truth. He is the truth that was present and was established from the beginning. He was there. The law was given through Moses, grace and truth came by him who was there at creation. Now this is kind of the things which, if you've been in what you might call the Hebrew Roots movement, these are things which have been established. But this is actually the foundation for us to understand the mark of the church and the sign of God, and how we can get to a place where there is little argument for people to not keep what is written, to live lives which are not complicit with what is written. This is why we have to do this. He is the Word, and the deception Yeshua warned his disciples about would deliberately lead many and attempt to lead even the elect away from truth. Matthew 24, verse 24. For there shall arise false Christs and false prophets, and shall show great signs and wonders, insomuch that, if it were possible, they shall deceive the very elect. Now this word elect is ekletos. These are the picked out, the called out, the chosen. These are the elect, the called out ones who join or are part of an ecclesia, which in the King James Bible is the church. So many shall be deceived, but if it were possible, even the elect shall be led astray. However, it's not possible to deceive the elect because they have been called out. They're chosen. So just like Peter, James, and John, who were called out, who were fishermen, who were living in a society which was filled with religious people, and Yeshua said, come and follow me, we are called out. And if it were possible, we could be deceived. But there's something which differentiates us from those who shall be deceived. We can see some of this in John chapter 10. So what we're going to find is what distinguishes the elect who shall not be deceived from the many who shall be deceived is that the elect have heard the voice. That's because they're called out. Now, if you're called out, if you're chosen and you have responded to the call, then there is a voice that you've heard to draw you from a place that you was in. We can see this kind of thing when we look at Abraham. Abraham was in a place where his father's house was, where his kindred was, and he was called out of that place. So he heard a voice. Verse 7. Then Jesus said unto them again, verily, verily, I say unto you, I am the door of the sheep. All that ever came before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not hear them. I am the door. By me, if any man enter in, he shall be saved, and shall go in and out and find pasture. The thief cometh not but for to steal and to kill and to destroy. I am come that they might have life and that they might have it more abundantly. Now, the people who are having the life and are having it more abundantly are the ones who are hearing his voice. The abundant life is not for those who don't hear his voice and are not his sheep. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd giveth his life for the sheep. But he that is a hireling and not the shepherd, whose own the sheep are not, seeth the wolf coming and leaveth the sheep and fleeth. And the wolf catcheth them and scattereth the sheep. The hireling fleeth because he is a hireling and careth not for the sheep. I am the good shepherd and know my sheep and am known of mine. Just an interesting thing is when you go into the Christian world and you look at hierarchy in the Christian church, what you see is that there's a structure as to how pastors are getting paid, how pastors are getting jobs. 9 times out of 10, there's a vacancy that needs to be filled and someone applies for that vacancy. Now, what comes to mind is, why is it that you need to be paid to do the work of being a pastor? Now, obviously, we know that there are Levites, there are priests, and they live off, according to Torah, they live off what is given to the temple. Every person needs a way to sustain themselves, but it just brings to mind the fact that it's basically like a recruitment agency, a recruitment drive, that there are vacancies made available and people apply. They will take their family from where they are and travel to another congregation because that's where the opportunity is, as opposed to Yeshua, who is not a hireling. Those who are called out and chosen shall not be deceived, because the same voice that called them is the voice they follow. There are those who are born in, or forced in, and married in. Then there are those who are called out. Now, you can find yourself in a place worshipping and believing and serving because you were born in. You can find yourself in a place because you were married into, but then there are those who are called out. And the Bible lets us know, and we can see it, we can reflect in our own lives, that a lot of the time the called out ones are individuals who have been in these places. They might have been born in these denominations. They might have been married into these denominations, and yet there is a voice which speaks to them that lets them know that they are to come out of the place that they have been in. My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. John 10:27. Those who are deceived don't know his voice and are not his sheep. This is not what I'm saying. This is what the scriptures are saying. Those who don't know his voice, those who are deceived, are not part of his sheep. Because the Bible lets us know that the elect, the called out ones, if it were possible, they'll be deceived. But it's not possible. Because these are individuals who know the voice. And when they hear a voice, they are intelligent enough to know that to discern the voice that they're hearing, all they have to do is search the scriptures. Those who are deceived don't know the voice and are not his sheep. They belong to another. And the mark of ownership, who you belong to, is who you follow and obey. This is the mark of ownership, who you follow and obey. This is something which is spoken about in Romans 6:16. Know ye not that to whom ye yield yourselves servants to obey, his servants ye are to whom ye obey, whether of sin unto death or of obedience unto righteousness. Whom you yield yourself servants to obey. So if there is some obedience which is taken place, because you're responding to a voice, then you become that individual or that organization's servant. The sheep follow the voice of the shepherd. They are known of him and he is known of them. Now this is, there is a myriad of quotes that can be used. And this is what we have here today. Sunday is our mark of authority. The church is above the Bible, and this transference of Sabbath observance is proof of that fact. The Catholic Record of London, Ontario, September 1st, 1923. Of course, the change from the Sabbath to Sunday was her act, and the act is a mark of her ecclesiastical power and authority in religious matters. Signed by H.F. Thomas, Chancellor for Cardinal Gibbons, in a letter dated 11th November 1895. So what we are seeing is that Yeshua, before he is crucified, he warns his disciples about deception, about false prophets and false Christs, false anointed ones, who shall deceive many. However, the elect, the called out ones, who know his voice because they are responding to the call, shall not be deceived. You become servants of whom you obey. Sin unto death and righteousness unto righteousness. Now the mark of authority for the church is the observation of Sunday. It's a mark of the ecclesiastical power. Yeshua warned his disciples about a deception coming, led by false Christs and false prophets that shall deceive many. However, the elect, the called out ones, the chosen, will not be deceived, because as his sheep, they know his voice. They recognize truth, a truth that was established in the beginning. So in the beginning was the Word, and then the Word was made flesh, full of grace and truth. Deception now is when you lead someone intentionally away from truth. Whoever you obey is who you serve, and the mark of the church is the observance of Sunday as the holy day, of which there is no scriptural authority. Now, according to Merriam-Webster, this is the definition of mark. It's a sign, an indication. For example, a mark of his esteem, an impression. For example, as a scratch, scar, or stain made on something. A distinguishing trait or quality. It's a characteristic. For example, the mark of an education person. A symbol used for identification or indication of ownership, a cross made in a place of a signature. So this is what is being spoken about when we're looking at the mark of the church. Now, when we are considering the mark of the church, we need to be clear that that church is not the same church which is written about in your King James Bible. This is a different church. See, the church, ecclesia, in your King James Bible, is an assembly of the called out ones, the ecclesitos. But this church, which is being spoken about when we've just looked at those quotes, is something very different. That will be made clear, perfectly clear, as we move on. Many have been deceived, led astray, led away from the path of truth, the word, by following false Christs and false prophets, as Messiah warned. And you can spend pretty much most of your day searching for quotes, and you will find them where the leaders of these churches consider their Heavenly Father to be a man. Not Yeshua, but a man who stands in the place of Yeshua. You can find quotes all day long, and that's the confession. False Christs, false prophets. Yeshua is truth, the word from the beginning, and if you hear his voice, follow him, then you are one of his. And we looked at that in John chapter 10. If it can therefore be proven that there is no scriptural authority for the transition of the observance of the Sabbath as the holy day, then the mark of the church is a sign of this deception. The mark of the church is a sign of this deception. If it can be proven, and I would put it to you, and over the course of time, it will very well be proven from the own sources, the horse's mouth, that it's clearly not biblical, which is why at the beginning, this is something that needs to be continually established. Just like in the church, which has its own mark to determine whose is theirs, God's people have a mark, which Jehovah established to distinguish who is his. Exodus 31. So again, we have the mark of the church and the sign of God. Verse 13, speak thou also unto the children of Israel, saying, verily my Sabbaths ye shall keep. Now this isn't a day that has been set aside by men. This isn't a day that has been set aside by people. It's days that have been set aside by Jehovah, which is why you will see quote after quote after quote, which detail and teach that there are men on earth who believe they have the authority to circumnavigate around, through, over and under the divine laws of Jehovah. For it is a sign, which is oath, Hebrew 226, sign, signal, a distinguishing mark. So now you have a Sabbath, which is a mark, and a Sunday, which is a mark. But they're marks of authority for two different parties. One is a mark belonging to Jehovah. The other is a mark which is belonging unto the church, but not the called out ones, not the ecclesia, another church. Between me and you throughout your generations, that ye may know that I am the Lord that doeth sanctify you. You shall keep the Sabbath, therefore, for it is holy unto you. Everyone that defileth it shall surely be put to death. For whosoever doeth any work therein, that soul shall be cut off from among his people. 6 days may work be done, but in the seventh is the Sabbath of rest, holy unto the Lord. Whosoever doeth any work in the Sabbath day, he shall surely be put to death. Wherefore the children of Israel shall keep the Sabbath, to observe the Sabbath throughout their generations, for a perpetual covenant. It is a sign between me and the children of Israel forever. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, and on the seventh day he rested and was refreshed. And he gave unto Moses, when he had made an end of communing with him upon Mount Sinai, two tables of testimony, tables of stone, written with the finger of God. That's the difference. You have commandments, Sabbaths, which are a sign, written by the finger of the Almighty. Now, if you are one of his, if you Jehovah sanctified you, and you have sanctified yourself to Jehovah, then the sign which was written on stone shall be written on your inward parts. The mark of the authority of the church, men, is that you reverence a day which has been sanctified by people. The Sabbath belongs to Jehovah. Sunday belongs to the church. And again, it's not the church that was in the wilderness or the church in Acts that went from house to house. This is another church completely. And this will be established. If you keep the Sabbaths, it is a perpetual sign between you and Jehovah, that you may know that Jehovah is your Elohim that sanctifies you, because whom you obey is who you are a servant of. If you observe Sunday, it is a mark of the church, that the church is above the word, the truth found in scriptures that was there in the beginning. It is therefore a sign of deception, intentionally leading many astray from truth in the word, to follow after the laws, customs, and traditions of men. This is exactly what Yeshua told his disciples to beware of. As a matter of fact, he told his disciples that they should go out and make disciples of the nations and teach the nations all things that he had commanded them. So he's teaching through his disciples the world to beware, to hold firm and to stand strong on the truth. He was the truth, but he was the truth that was established in the beginning. So we have another quote here. But since Saturday, not Sunday, is specified in the Bible, isn't it curious that non-Catholics who claim to take their religion directly from the Bible and not from the church observe Sunday instead of Saturday? Yes, of course, it is inconsistent, but this change was made about 15 centuries before Protestantism was born. And by that time, the custom was universally observed. The custom was universally observed. They have continued the custom, even though it rests upon the authority of the church and not upon the explicit text in the Bible. So again, these quotes here are making it clear there's a distinction between the word, the sign of Jehovah, and the church, the customs, the traditions of men. That observance remains as a reminder of the mother church from which the non-Catholic sect broke away, like a boy running away from home but still carrying in his pocket a picture of his mother or a lock of hair. And that is a quote from John A. O'Brien, The Faith of Millions. The church made a sacred day of Sunday, largely because it is the weekly festival of the sun. For it was a definite Christian policy to take over the pagan festivals endeared to the people by tradition and to give them a Christian significance. Arthur Weigel, from The Paganism in Our Christianity. This is what Yeshua says about traditions. This is what Yeshua says about traditions. In Matthew 15, verse 1. Then came to Jesus scribes and Pharisees, which were of Jerusalem, saying, "Why do the disciples transgress the traditions of the elders? For they wash not their hands when they eat bread." But he answered and said unto them, "Why do ye also transgress the commandment of God by your traditions?" Now this is how we can look at Judaism and Christianity and see a theme in the Bible. In some ways, Judaism and Christianity are very much the same. They're very similar, probably because they came from the same place. For God commanded, saying, "Honor thy father and mother, and he that curseth father or mother, let him die the death. But ye say, whosoever shall say to his father or his mother, it is a gift, by whatsoever thou mightest be profited by me, and honor not his father or his mother, he shall be free. Thus have ye made the commandment of God of none effect by your tradition. Ye hypocrites, well did Isaiah prophesy of you, saying, This people draweth nigh unto me with their mouth, and honor me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. But in vain they do worship me, teaching for doctrines the commandments of men." Yeshua laid the gauntlet down and let the people at his time who he was encountering in Israel, that the traditions were causing their worship to be in vain. Now imagine some thousand plus years later, we have a situation where people go to a worship service on a day biblically which has been not prescribed. The traditions of men, the doctrines of men, make the commandments of God of null effect. The worship of Jehovah is deemed vanity when the traditions of men make the commandments of Jehovah of null effect. And we're going to see that making the commandments of Jehovah of none effect isn't something which has been swept under the carpet. It is proclaimed from the rooftops. It's proclaimed. And it has been swallowed up by the many who have been deceived, led intentionally away from the path of truth. Then understood they how that he bade them not beware of the leaven of bread, but to beware of the doctrine of the Pharisees and of the Sadducees. In Yeshua's day, Yeshua was warning these people about such things, the doctrines of men, the hypocrisy of religious people. Not to be involved in it. Stay well clear of it. The deception Yeshua warned his disciples about, which will lead many astray, takes place when people shift their attention from the word, Yeshua, to the false anointed ones and prophets teaching another doctrine, teaching tradition. If there's no scriptural authority, why are the people submitting to the authority? People are submitting to the authority is because they've shifted their attention from the scriptures, from the word, to the people. You can look at Jesus, you can read what Jesus said, but when you're looking at your pastor, your bishop, your priest, or your father, instead of looking at Jesus to tell you what Jesus taught, that's how you can be easily deceived. And it's absolutely incredible that these things were written in our Bibles, oftentimes in red, for us to see, and yet still people can't see it. Because Isaiah did prophesy, they will have eyes and they will not see. The observation of Sunday is a church tradition, making the perpetual everlasting sign of Jehovah, his Sabbaths, commandment, commanded in the law of null effect. Now this is from the, it's a long quote, Catechism of the Catholic Church. Now from my understanding and from what I have seen, the Catechism of the Catholic Church is essentially the equivalent, from what I understand, what I see, of the Talmud. It's a compilation of doctrine, positions, teachings over the years. So people who, I guess, people who want to have a better understanding of what the church believes can have it in like an 800-page document. And this is taken from page 24, and the numbering system has it from 77. In order that the full and living gospel might always be preserved in the church, this is that church, not the church, the apostles left bishops as their successors. Now these bishops who they left as successors are not any of the bishops or deacons or servants we hear about in the Bible. We don't see them in the Bible. But these, according to this position, they left their belief, their doctrine to these bishops. They gave them their own position of teaching authority. Indeed, the apostolic preaching, which is expressed in a special way in the inspired books, was to be preserved in a continuous line of succession until the end of time. This living transmission, accomplished in the Holy Spirit, is called tradition. Tradition with a capital T. Tradition. Since, and here is an interesting thing, since it is distinct from the sacred scripture, though closely connected to it, through tradition, the church, in her doctrine, life, and worship, perpetuates and transmits to every generation all that she herself is, all that she believes. In other words, you have this doctrine which has been put together by tradition. That's not something that's denied. It's not something that's denied. It's something which is embraced to the degree that you can pick up the textbook school manual of the Christian church and it will be there. These traditions, according to this manual, is distinct from the scriptures. Is different from the scriptures. Apparently, the apostles had some successors who established these traditions. Now, we just have right here a situation which is exactly the same as Judaism. According to Judaism, Jehovah gave his commandments, which were then written on stone, to Moses, or to the people, and then to Moses, to give to the people. However, according to the tradition, there were some additional instructions. The oral commandments, which were given to Moses, which were then given to the elders, which were then given to the teachers, the rabbis, and so on and so forth. In this situation, it's pretty much the same thing. You have Yeshua, you have the apostles, and they're the ones who inspired the scriptures, the New Testament writings. However, what they're saying is that the apostles taught the bishops some new teachings which we don't see in the Bible, and these new teachings are called tradition, which is distinct, separate from the Bible. Is everyone following me so far? The sayings of the Holy Fathers are a witness to the life-giving presence of this tradition, showing how its riches are poured out in the practice of the Christian of life of the Christian church. In her belief and her prayers, the Father's self-communication made through the Word in the Holy Spirit remains present and active in the church. God, who spoke in the past, continues to converse with the spouse of his beloved Son. And the Holy Spirit, through whom the living voice of the gospel rings out in the church and through her in the world, leads believers to the full faith. So essentially, this Bible that we have, this faith that was once delivered to the saints, is not full. This isn't the full faith. To receive the full faith, you need to listen to some teachings, some doctrines, which didn't come from anyone written in this Bible. It didn't come from a people who are part of the people in this Bible. Leads the believer into the full truth and makes the word of Christ dwell in them in all its richness. Sacred tradition and sacred scripture then are bound closely together and communicate one with the other, for both of them following out the same divine wellspring, come together in some fashion to form one thing and move towards the same goal. Each of them makes present the faithful in the church, the mystery of Christ, who promised to remain with his own always to the close of the age. So again, according to church doctrine, where this mark of being under the authority of the church comes from, there is some traditions which come from people who are not in the Bible, who don't come from the culture, which makes this word complete. The church which boasts the tradition, leading and legislating away from the Sabbath to Sunday, predicates traditions distinct from the sacred scriptures, the words which is the truth. According to the Catechism of the Catholic Church, these traditions stem not from Yeshua the Word, or from his disciples, the apostles, but from their successors, bishops, Gentiles never mentioned in the Bible. Yeshua said, "Beware of the doctrine of religious men. Beware lest false Christ and prophets deceive you, teaching you men's words instead of Jehovah's." The Sabbath is a sign between you and Jehovah that he has sanctified you, and Sunday is the mark of being under the authority of the church, a religious institution distinguished from the word by the traditions of men, which make the commandments of Jehovah of null effect. And we're coming soon to the close, so hang on with me. But we have the Catechism of the Catholic Church 469. There's a reason why we're going and we're hanging out in this book, and I believe we're probably going to cover that in the next teaching. But essentially, all that exists today in terms of doctrine pertaining to the observation of Sunday stems from the church, the Catholic Universal Church. Doesn't stem from Scripture. And the more time that is spent teaching the truth, then the less people there will be deceived in the area of observation of the Shabbat. And this is page 469. See, I told you it's a meaty book. Jesus rose from the dead on the first day of the week. Because it is the first day, the day of Christ's resurrection recalls the first creation, because it's the eighth day following the Sabbath. So now there's some teaching about the resurrection on Sunday. Now there's some teaching of numerology, the eighth day, creation, and so on. Matt, it symbolizes the new creation ushered in by Christ's resurrection. For Christians, it has become the first of all days, the first of all feasts, the Lord's Day, Sunday. Now, regardless of whether you're a Catholic, a Protestant, and if you're part of a Protestant, Pentecostal, Baptist, whatever denomination is, this is where it comes from. This is where it will all go back to, the Lord's Day. This is he rose on Sunday. It's the Lord's Day. We all gather on the day of the sun. This is another quote in this book. For it is the first day after the Jewish Sabbath, which we've established is not a Jewish Sabbath. It's a day of Jehovah. It's Jehovah's day, which he sanctified and set aside to meet with his people. Got nothing to do with Judaism, but also the first day when God, separating matter from darkness, made the world. And on this same day, Jesus, our Savior, rose from the dead. Now, wouldn't it be interesting if you from the Bible could prove that Jesus didn't raise on Sunday? What would you have to do with this 600 plus page book? You have to do something with it. Sunday, fulfillment of the Sabbath. Sunday is expressly distinguished from the Sabbath, which it follows chronologically every week. For Christians, its ceremonial observance replaces that of the Sabbath. Now, when you read this text, you will quickly find there's actually no scripture. Throughout the book, even though there's some serious faulty doctrine, they will at least, to some degree, try and pin a scripture to what is being taught. However, when it comes down to the Sabbath, you won't find a scripture that justifies what they're talking about, this transference. In Christ's Passover, Sunday fulfills the spiritual truth of the Jewish Sabbath and announces man's eternal rest in God. This is why you will speak to, regardless of whether they're Baptist or Pentecostal, when you're talking about the Sabbath, people will make the comment, but isn't Jesus my rest? Jesus is my rest. That's why this is where it comes from. For worship under the law prepared for the mystery of Christ, and what was done there prefigured some aspects of Christ. Those who lived according to the old order of things have come to a new hope, no longer keeping the Sabbath, but the Lord's Day, in which our life is blessed by him and by his death. The celebration of Sunday observes the moral commandment inscribed by nature in the human heart to render God an outward, visible, public and regular worship as a sign of his universal benevolence to all. So even there's now an acknowledgement that Father gave the people a sign and the people give Father a sign. Sunday worship fulfills the moral command of the old covenant. I would question that. I would seriously question that. Taking up its rhythm and spirit in the weekly celebration of the Creator and Redeemer of all people. Sunday celebration of the Lord's Day is his Eucharist, and his Eucharist, sorry, is at the heart of church life. Sunday is the day on which the Paschal mystery is celebrated in the light of the apostolic tradition. Again, none of this makes sense or holds any water whatsoever, excluding the embracing of tradition. Now, when they're talking about apostolic tradition, they're not talking about the same traditions which Paul writes about when he's writing his epistles. If you follow these ordinances, if you follow these traditions, you shall be well, and so on. He's not talking about those. This is talking about apostolic traditions we don't see in the Bible. No one ever mentions in the Bible, which is supposedly passed down to people we never hear about in the Bible, who then take over the leadership, or supposedly take over the leadership of the church, and transfer the church, the ecclesia, the called out ones, to a Sabbath, to the observance of a Sunday. Sunday is the day on which the Paschal mystery is celebrated in the light of the apostolic tradition and is to be observed as the foremost holy day of obligation in the universal church. Not one passage of scripture. Now this is in the section of the Ten Commandments and how it's important to observe the Ten Commandments in the light of the revelation of Yeshua Messiah, and there's not one passage which shows us there's a transference. This is what Yeshua says in Mark 2 verse 27. And he said unto them, the Sabbath was made for man, which is why it's important for us to understand the Sabbath, despite what is written or what you are told, the Sabbath wasn't made for Jewish people. The Sabbath was made for man. The people that Jehovah told to remember his Sabbath, none of them was Jewish. None of them was Jewish. You had a people who represented the tribe of Judah, but none of them was Jewish. None of them, the Sabbath was made for man, and not man for the Sabbath. Therefore, the Son of Man is Lord also of the Sabbath. So if the Son of Man is Lord also of the Sabbath, if the Son of Man is going to have a day because he is Lord, then the Lord's day is going to be a Sabbath. If the Son of Man is Lord of the Sabbath, if he has a day, it's going to be a Sabbath. Does that make sense? Amen? And we're finishing up here. As a means to tie the word Yeshua to the transition the church predicates, the Sabbath to Sunday, a tradition, a custom, a doctrine of men has been manufactured that can be biblically proven to be false. And we are going to biblically prove this doctrine, this Lord's Day, this Sunday resurrection to be false from the Bible. I'm not going to give this word to some people behind me and then say it's a mystery, and then they tell you, Marcus told me. No, I'm going to show you in your Bible that it's going to be false. This tradition has been swallowed up by the world, leading to the deception of, and it's over, 99% of 2.2 billion Christians who observe Sunday. It's over that because from what I remember, when I checked the percentage of Seventh-day Adventists, or the number, I think it was around about 18 million registered, like professed, baptized Seventh-day Adventists. Now, when you think about it, of those 18 million, there are still those who reject the overwhelming majority of the things which cause you to be part of that ecclesia. Which is why Yeshua tells the people, this is a very straight and narrow road, and there will be few that find it. Many will fall by the wayside, many will be deceived, but few are called and chosen. Yeshua is Lord of the Sabbath. So if the Lord therefore has any day, it will be the day he is Lord of. The Sabbath was made for man, not the Jews. The Lord's day, according to church tradition, is Sunday because of the resurrection, which then justifies their deception to lead people away from the truth, the word that teaches the Sabbath. You can't just transition people from the Sabbath to a Sunday without trying to bring Jesus into the mix somewhere. There's no scripture to justify it, but if I can convince people that Jesus rose on Sunday, if I can convince people that, even though it's not in the Bible, then I can convince people that this pagan day of the sun is the day Jesus, the new creation, gave us permission to observe his holy day. And I'm telling you, it's not in the Bible. And I'm saying that to you knowing that you know. But like what I said from the beginning, I'm not just speaking to everyone here. I'm not even just speaking to people who may be watching online. Live, there's people who might watch this tape in a year, in 2 years. There are people who when it becomes a book, if it becomes a book, you might be able to give that in their hand, and then boom, this is why we're doing this. The Lord's Day, according to church tradition, is Sunday because of the resurrection, which then justifies their deception to lead people away from the truth, the word which teaches the Sabbath. However, biblically, the Lord's Day, Resurrection Sunday, took place on the weekly Sabbath, which is Saturday. Therefore, take heed to the warning of Yeshua. Be not deceived. Endure on truth until the end, and you shall be saved. Now, in the next part of the teachings, that's when we'll go into how to look at the Lord's Day, the supposed Lord's Day, how you can see from the Bible that Jesus never rose on Resurrection Sunday. We know that this whole church about Good Friday and Easter Sunday, it doesn't make sense. So what that says to me, if you can prove that he never rose on the Sunday, there's no case for the Lord's Day. There's no case for the Sunday resurrection, there's no case for this new creation. There is no case biblically for anybody to be observing Sunday as opposed to the Sabbath, which this Bible teaches from Genesis pretty much to Revelation. Amen? Amen. Hallelujah. Is there any questions about some of the stuff that we went over today? I know I've, like I said from the very beginning, I wanted to forego a lot of the announcements so we could really get down in the word today. So you have been very, very patient. So thank you for that. Is there any questions about anything that was said today? Awesome. Do you want to come up to the front?
Yeah, Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom.
Yeah, it's a. I just want to say this. It's a really, really interesting subject matter, and it's something that, in fact, I was looking at just last night. So when I walked in, I thought, hang on a minute, something's going on here. I just wanted to point out that how that the everyone's sort of always talking about the, you know, what is the mark of the beast and so on and so on that they find in the Book of Revelation. And this, there's so much evidence that points in the direction of the tradition of the church, that's what the mark is. And when you look at Deuteronomy 18, where it talks about bind, how the Lord wants to bind his word on as a sign. If we can look it up, I forgot to bring it up. If you could find it for me. Deuteronomy 11:18. Sorry.
Okay.
Yeah.
Therefore shall ye lay up these my words in your heart and in your soul, and bind them for a sign upon your hand, that they may be as frontlets between your eyes.
Mm. So that it kind of speaks to the, in Revelation, how that the beast has its own mark, and how that it would it's really the submitting to that system, to that form of worship, that causes you to receive that mark. So I'm just really sort of running a parallel with how the Lord has asked of us to bind upon our hand and our as a sign, and frontless to our eyes as a sign that we've actually bounded our soul to Him, essentially. So when you look at the parallel as to what the beast is the mark of the beast is, it's quite serious. You are actually binding your soul to a system or to a form of worship which is forbidden, really, which is Antichrist. So it's just something I wanted to bring up, because it's something I was actually looking at last night. And that's it, really. But it's great teaching. Thank you.
Amen. And there's plenty of, we've gone sort of down, and I spent hours reading quote after quote after quote about, you know, God and the Pope are the same, Jesus is the Pope, and all of this kind of stuff. But we've sort of just stuck going down the road we've gone down today, because you literally, if you wanted to, you could purchase the book, which is like the manual for yourself, and you can read it for yourself. Some of these quotes, which have been like hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years ago, they're very difficult to get hold of. But this book, you can purchase for yourself, and you can show people what it says. And if people want to live a life which isn't really based on the word, but on traditions of people we don't really know much about, then that's fine by them. But for us, if we desire to be prepared to be the bride, we need to be cleaned up. We need to be purified, sanctified, cleansed. And that involves obedience to what is written. So again, you know, share teachings like this. There isn't many teachings or ministries that go into some of the areas that we go into. And hopefully it will bless and provoke your family, friends, and so on. Is there anything else before we close in prayer, unless there's prayer requests? Yes. Yeah. And what is his name?
Mauricio.
Mauricio. Mauricio. Is there any other prayer requests? Okay. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we sanctify your name and we bless you that through your servant Yeshua, through your son, our master, that we know that where two or three are gathered in your name, in his name, there you are in the midst. So we ask at this time that you will stretch forth your hand over Mauricio and you will heal him. We know that your power has no end. There is no distance which is too far for you. That you are everywhere and always with us. So we pray that he will experience a supernatural healing. That he will experience a touch that comes from heaven. To the degree that he knows that there has been something taking place in his body, in his mind, in his heart, which will draw him back to covenant relation with you. I pray in Yeshua's name that you will use Grace. You will use her as a light, as an ambassador to the kingdom, so that the people far away may know that when they call Grace, when they call Grace, who has the ear of the Father in heaven, that their prayers will be answered. But furthermore, we ask that they will experience for themselves a relationship with you, which will give them the ability to pray for themselves, to pray for each other directly, because they have access through Yeshua to the throne room of Grace. So in Yeshua's name, we command sickness and infirmity to flee from his body. We command pain to cease in Yeshua's name. We bind up every force of darkness which may be manifesting around him and command and speak life into his life. May he be healed. May he be made whole. May he be delivered. For it is written, by the stripes of Yeshua, we are healed. And we declare his healing. We declare his deliverance in faith. And I pray for all of your people. I pray and I bring myself, my family, and your people before you. And I'm praying, Father, that we will be a people who do not allow this world to grind us down. We know that we're living in a time which we are told that it shall grind us down by changing times, by changing laws, which causes us at times to feel like we are in conflict with our families, with our friends. But we've also seen in the scriptures that there will be a time when your spirit flows into the dry bones, when your people who you have called from the foundation of the earth shall stand shoulder to shoulder. May you use us to sow them seeds. May you use us to repair the breach. May you use us, Father, to be the ambassadors of the kingdom that welcomes people, that brings reconciliation to man back in covenant with you. Go before your people this week. Go before me. Prepare doorways of opportunities for us to share your good news. And bless your people. May every need be met. May the resources that they need to get by and prosper be provided for them. May you raise up people who will give into their bosom as they have given into mine and into yours. I bless them in Yeshua's name. Receive your blessing. May Jehovah bless you and keep you. May Jehovah cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May Jehovah lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. In Yeshua's name, amen. 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 So, at this point, there is one comment that I'm going to read online. I don't think there's any prayer requests or anything like that I can see, but I know you've been here long, so if you want to, you can have some food or fellowship while I just read this before we close. So this is from PJ. Well, Marcus, I can't wait to share this with some of my Catholic family members. Good. I'm glad. What an awesome teaching. Praise Jehovah for your obedience. I was raised Catholic, and even as a child, I and one of my brothers could not reconcile what we were being taught and shown to what we found in the Bible. And yet family members remain entrenched in what are simply lies. This teaching is the ice pick that may poke a hole in the explanations and justifications for why they continue to ignore the Sabbath. Thank you. Praise Jehovah for that. And that is exactly the purpose of going down this direction. So you've got something, and I'm clued up to date, and we've all got resources for us to say, look, this is what it says in your own doctrine, and so on. Unless there's anything else. Okay, bless you all. Jehovah bless you. Have a prosperous week. Shabbat shalom. Shabbat shalom. Shabbat shalom.